Welcome everyone to the OneWelbeck webinar on long COVID. I'm Di Loudon. I'm a GP in Chelsea. We're all seeing a lot of acute COVID cases, but we're likely to be seeing an increasing number of long COVID. And I think recent estimates from the ONS said that about 10% of people who have a COVID infection will then go on to experience further symptoms. And long COVID is interesting in that some of the symptoms are common at the start, they resolve, and then they're replaced by different ones later on. So it's very much a multi-system illness. So it's important to look at it from a multidisciplinary way. And so for that reason, we've got consultants from three different specialties tonight. The webinar is going to be divided into three sections: cardiology, respiratory, and then ENT. And at the end, we're going to have a question and answer session. So I'd encourage you to use the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen, and then I can put those questions to the panel. So OneWelbeck's known for its innovative specialists. We've got three brilliant speakers tonight. I'm going to hand over to Boon Lin first. He's a consultant cardiologist at Imperial, and he's particularly interested in the autonomic dysfunction as one of the causes for symptoms of long COVID.
Thank you very much, Di, for the kind introduction, and thank you all for attending this conference. So the title of my talk is Autonomic Dysfunction in Long COVID. I'm a cardiologist and electrophysiologist, and I run the Imperial Syncope Diagnostic Unit, where we perform something like 800 to 1,000 tilt table tests every year to investigate patients with syncope, but also autonomic dysfunction syndromes. And we can see patients with orthostatic intolerance and a patient cohort with POTS, or postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome. And this is where the story starts, which is autonomic dysfunction is one of the key things that we see very clearly in our tilt table test practice. But if you look back as far back as 1871 in the US Civil War, a Portuguese physician called Jacob da Costa noticed in hundreds, if not thousands, of patients returning from the battlefield, a syndrome of what he eventually described as the irritable heart syndrome, which was characterized by shortness of breath, whilst resting, palpitations and anxiety, all worsened by standing. And interestingly, a lot of these patients had not even seen the had not even been at the battlefield. So these were patients of his who were sat down in preparation for war, but who had not seen battle. And that was one of the more interesting principles in which he was able to describe that the orthostatic component, or the change in symptoms as the postural change occurred, started to make him think about the role in which the autonomic nervous system played in giving these patients a whole multifaceted symptom profile. Later on, obviously seen in the First and Second World Wars, Iraq, Vietnam, and known as several things: shell shock syndrome, post-traumatic stress, post-Vietnam syndrome. And interestingly, the soldier's own narrative, which is very similar to some of the POTS patients that I see, the narrative that they have about the causation would be, from the soldier's perspective, exposure to chemicals or even vaccines that they were forced to take before getting into the battlefield. And of course, the extreme pressures of war. And this is something replicated in the group of patients who are coming to see us with POTS. So the clear triggers that I've seen in the group of patients coming for POTS include stress and predisposition factors, namely hypotensive states and hypermobile syndromes. And oftentimes the triggers for POTS can be quite a severe intercurrent viral illness. Now, this, I think, very nicely described article published recently did a survey of patients with long COVID and surveyed 3,700 respondents from 56 countries. And in this survey, they looked at a whole number of different symptoms. And I've just picked out one of the perhaps 50 graphs available on this document that, by the way, Rupal will now send to all of you as an attachment in the chat. So please go ahead and download this together with the other article that I will send. And essentially, these are symptoms that remain 6 months after a initial infection with COVID with post-exertional malaise. And if you can look at the circle things in red, I would say that a lot of these symptoms are commonly seen in patients with POTS. Now, I'm not saying people with long COVID have POTS, but the symptoms are very similar, or the symptom description. And I know these are really focusing on mainly the malaise aspect, headaches, insomnia, palpitation, shortness of breath. But there are other graphs here that tell us about the other systems, which I will come on to talk about. And here they are. If I take this simplistic diagram about how stress affects the body, this is a simple cartoon, and I now overlay, and you can take your time to read it slowly, but if I overlaid some of these other graphics that are available from this extensive survey, you can see that in the skin, patients with long COVID describe itchy skin, rashes in up to 50, 60, 70% of patients. Patients with long COVID describe gastrointestinal symptoms, including diarrhea, loss of appetite, nausea, abdominal pain and cramp in up to 50 to 70% of patients. People with long COVID describe changes in immune system regulation. And here in the context of the heart, they describe palpitations and tachycardia. And look here, almost all, up to 90% of patients with long COVID have this as their dominant symptom. So palpitations, tachycardia, burning in chest. And of course, all these other symptoms, such as extreme thirst, irregular periods, early menopause, and a lot more other graphics. So if we move forward and we look at what happens during the tilt table test, because this is where I've learned to look at the autonomic signals or signatures in expression of sympathetic versus parasympathetic. This is a normal patient. And in the supine position in the first 5 minutes that you can see here, in the supine position, what you'll find is that the heart rate here sits at about 65. The blood pressure is pretty stable at 140 over 80. And during the head up tilt, which occurs at 5 minutes, the blood pressure may dip slightly before it comes up again and stabilize throughout this period. At 20 minutes, at this point, GTN is given sublingually. And then the blood pressure here is seen to continue to be fairly stable, but the heart rate increases. And this increase in heart rate is a manifestation of sympathetic drive or activation of the fight or flight response to try and maintain a degree of vasoconstriction because GTN causes vasodilatation. So the pooling in the lower limbs, particularly, which are huge reservoirs of blood, can lead to a transient drop in blood pressure, which you don't really see in this very well-conditioned patient, but you do see the signature of a slight sympathetic increase because the heart rate increases here due to the sympathetic drive. So standing is a sympathetic influence, in this case, a little bit. GTN is more of a sympathetic influence. Now let's look, for example, now at a 31-year-old patient of mine, whose name is Louise Mawson. She won't mind because I've recorded her live and she's available on the Arrhythmia Alliance website telling her story and some of the successes in her long COVID journey. But this was a tilt. So similar to the normal tilt, you would see a 5 minute window here of the supine position with fairly stable blood pressures. All these spikes are artifact of the calibration that is done with the Phenopress machine, which is a non-invasive beat-to-beat blood pressure cuff, which is placed on the fingertip. And here you can see on the heart rate trace, Louisa's blood pressure is sitting around there at about, heart rate is sitting at around 78 beats per minute. But immediately on standing, unlike the normal patient I showed, the heart rate shoots up here to 105 beats per minute. And this occurs and magnifies an oscillatory pattern that you can see now in the blood pressure. I don't know if you can see the lines that I'm pointing out to you. And if I can draw, this is 125 on one moment, but just 10 seconds before that, this was 80. And then before that, it was 110. Before that, it was 90. This yo-yoing oscillations of the blood pressure are somewhat mirrored by the oscillations in heart rate, as you can see here, that go between 80 and 120 beats per minute in a 10-second cycle. So this is a marker of autonomic imbalance, specifically where the baroreflex, which are the very sensitive receptors in the neck, are responding by reduced filling pressures in the heart, which in turn are reduced because the volume coming up the inferior vena cava is now parked very firmly down in the lower limbs, the huge reservoirs of blood. So this patient has lost about 800 mils of blood just by standing up or being tilted upright. And the consequence to her autonomic activation is very clear to see here. And so this is a heightened sympathetic response, sympathetic nervous system response, and potentially a reduced vagal response. Now, she only is able to complete something like 15 minutes of the tilt, because all these lines you can see are marker lines that we write down. And these are when this patient is saying, stop, please, I'm feeling very unwell with dizziness, with heat, with shortness of breath, with palpitations. And at this point, although the blood pressure is still a respectable 85 over 60, and the heart rate is very respectable at 105, this patient can no longer tolerate the tilt table test. So on the basis of her data, together with some other initial data seen very early on in the long COVID pathway, we published this article on the 1st of January this year. And on it, we underscore some of the basic principles of management of long COVID. And really, you can take your time to read this article because it will be attached to this talk. But really, the principles here are education, exercise, fluid and salt repletion, avoiding exacerbating factors, learning to perform isometric exercises, wearing compression garments, and considering pharmacological treatment. Now, I won't go into the detail because of the time restraints, but we'll take questions at the end if you had specific questions at the end. But really what I wanted to talk about and what we don't do enough as physicians is really think about how to influence the autonomic nervous system. And this has come through, from my point of view, an experiential learning process. And learning from patients is wonderful as Louise. Now, Louise is this lady highlighted here. And again, I would urge you to go to this website and click on the link and actually ask your patients to click on this link, because she shares a very compelling journey of healing. And the healing is not only through the things that we talked about and I wrote about in that article, but her journey of healing comes in so many other ways. And this has made me think about autonomic rehabilitation in two ways. Firstly, a top-down approach, which I guess no one talks about, but part of the patient's journey here needs to be centered around education. And this education needs to be given in a way that is bite-sized and layperson-centric, so that the education and information that's provided can set a realistic expectation of recovery. And that expectation leads to a hope of recovery, the fact that they are listened to, and the fact that this top-down approach can influence the autonomic nervous system, so-called subconscious nervous system. And guess what? Thoughts, emotions, feelings, positivity, which are given by things like gratitude and compression and compassion exercises whilst breathing, are some of the things in common that my patients have fed back to me, including a wonderful patient from this morning, not Louise, but another patient who said the biggest improvement in her symptoms came when she joined a yoga class with like-minded COVID patients. There were 25 of them on a Zoom call, and they fed into each other the symptoms and the journeys of recovery. And this has been one of the most spectacular healing by social media aspects that I've seen in all of the patients, the second being in POTS. So the bottom-up approach is the other way you can influence the autonomic nervous system. And this is something I've been trying to do myself. And here we think of yoga as the archetypal top to bottom and bottom up approach. Because in yoga, you do asanas, which is a postural maintenance. In yoga, you do the breathing or prana. And this breath actually does influence the autonomic nervous system because it actually exerts control on your heart rate variability and changes your heart rate pattern. And if we have time, I'd like to show you at the end of this talk. One thing I've had some success with is biofeedback sensors. For those people who don't do yoga or can't really do Zoom calls, having biofeedback sensors have been remarkable. Full feedback I won't talk about now, but it's a very compelling state of healing that may come into play at a later stage. Think about it as the opposite of how your patients might feel if they had a warm bath. And patients with POTS and basivagal syncope do not like to get in baths because when they stand up, they faint. So what is the opposite of a warm bath? A cold shower. This is my reference list. I'm running out of time, but some of these will be sent to you and you can look up and watch these videos and ask your patients to watch these videos, which I think will be very helpful for them. I'm going to stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Boon. That was really interesting. I think it's really interesting, isn't it, with the patients with long COVID have been so good at reporting their symptoms. I think it's 33,000 on the long COVID Facebook group. And it's how we move that observational data, isn't it, into treatment and a management for them. So we're going to move on to Dr. Luke Howard. Luke is respiratory consultant at the Hammersmith. He is the pulmonary hypertension lead there. He's also involved in the rapid emboli service, which is obviously very busy at the moment. And he's going to give our respiratory talk.
Thank you very much. So do just shout if you're seeing the wrong screen. Yeah, so thanks very much. And it's always very difficult following somebody like Boon, who just pushes technological boundaries of presentation to another level. I've never seen anybody actually draw on their slides before. I think the best I can probably manage, and I'm going to try and do this, is to have a laser pointer. So that's that tells you the difference between a cardiologist and a pulmonologist. So I'm going to talk about the respiratory aspects. And it's notable that when you look, you go on the NHS website for a definition of long COVID, we come pretty much at the top in terms of respiratory symptoms, shortness of breath, and, well, chest pain or tightness, you might expect that to be referred to a cardiologist. But of course, it can all get lumped in together. And it's very rare it's quite rare to see a patient who presents with shortness of breath and who hasn't had symptoms of chest pain. And it seems to be a real feature of long COVID and quite difficult to explain. So certainly we're up on the list of people to refer to. This is quite a nice resource. I'm just moving your faces out of my vision. So this is quite a nice resource, the NICE guidance, NICE guideline 188, published fairly recently on long COVID. And I think it's helpful just to try and clarify some of the definitions. So I've drawn out here sort of a pathway to respiratory long COVID. So of course, we start off with the acute infection, which is multi-organ, of course, not just affecting the lungs, but having a big impact on thrombosis, pulmonary thrombosis and thromboembolism, which, as Di said, is keeping me busy. Then we go within 4 to 12 weeks after the onset of symptoms, we have what NICE describe as ongoing COVID symptoms. So from a respiratory perspective, the sorts of things that we're picking up at this stage are things like organizing pneumonia, pulmonary fibrosis. A bit cautious about calling it fibrosis because quite a lot of it goes away. And in my mind, fibrosis is permanent. But so just a bit cautious about calling it that. And then chronic thromboembolic disease or subacute thromboembolic disease and even pulmonary hypertension. And then we have post-COVID syndrome, which is beyond the 12-week marker. And so I suppose, strictly speaking, what many of us are talking about is post-COVID syndrome as opposed to long COVID. So NICE defined these two things together effectively as long COVID. So post-COVID syndrome is after 12 weeks. And what is it from a respiratory perspective? Well, is it this, respiratory symptoms with no underlying cardiopulmonary pathophysiology? Is that what we're really thinking this means? Otherwise, if you've got pathophysiology, well, you'd call it that. You'd call it a long-term complication rather than post-COVID syndrome. The thing is that the more you look for something, the more you'll find it. So once you start doing cardiac MRIs and, you know, fancy helium scans and certain xenon scans, you'll start finding more and more and more things, and then you'll have to call it something else. And maybe it doesn't fit into this slightly more nebulous category of post-COVID syndrome. And the other thing, of course, is all this is pretty new to us, and we're learning as we go along. And finally, just to say, doesn't matter how severe your symptoms are at the beginning, this does not predict the severity of post-COVID syndrome. I suspect you all fully realise that. Now, this is my little graphic of illustrating what happens with the more tests that you do in your patient post-COVID. So the more tests you do, well, you'll narrow your differential diagnosis right down to a sweet spot. And then if you carry on doing even more tests, then as we know, you can come up with many, many more diagnoses. And in the era of fake news, well, of course, many of these can be fake diagnoses or irrelevant diagnoses. I say fake because who knows what some of the stuff we're finding, if it ever turns out to be anything real or indeed relevant to the patient's symptoms. Of course, there is a point where doing some investigations is reassuring to patients, but you start doing more and more, and that can lead to over-medicalization. Unfortunately, the more tests you do, the more it's going to cost, although, of course, you might reduce resource use by actually having a more precise diagnosis. And then, so what leads to the best management? Well, I've slightly cheekily divided this into the private sector and the public sector in terms of use of resources. So clearly in the public sector, we are a bit more limited in what we can do. So it may be that the most optimal management, when you put everything together in terms of patient outcomes, resource use and the money available, is slightly further to the left than in a private sector, where we do have a little bit more flexibility to investigate people and follow their symptoms up. But I'm pretty pleased to say, at least in my experience at Imperial, these things pretty much match up, I feel very lucky to be as well resourced as I am. So how do we find that sweet spot? Well, I think there's a combination of factors, certainly taking an adequate history and using some questionnaires, and I'll present one to you in a minute. The more experience we gain, and then, of course, dependent on the availability of the investigations we have, then we're able to make a tentative diagnosis of long COVID because we're able to exclude all of the other potential complications. This then leads to us implementing a management strategy, and I think really important to have that regular review. And then, of course, after that, you can confirm or, in fact, be prepared to refute the diagnosis if you find that management isn't going according to plan. I think one other important thing, and I hope this is going to be largely correct, and I'm sure it will be, is that most of these patients are going to get better on their own with time. And we really need to make sure that we identify the minority with pathology which can be dealt with. And of course, some of the things can't be. It's important to make sure that we reassure those patients where, you know, we can find certain features on history or examination that we've found the thing that that is causing the problem. And then we have, I think, basically a hand-holding exercise where we are helping these patients get back to normal with physical, emotional, psychological support. And part of it, I think, is just making sure we're keeping the patient's mind busy, giving them feedback to stop it from wandering down alleyways, which are not helpful. So from a general practice perspective, of course, if you're faced with a patient that you think has long COVID, it's important to make sure, certainly in the 4 to 12 week period, that we're excluding life-threatening things such as severe hypoxemia or severe lung disease or cardiac disease. And then what NICE recommends is some basic investigations. So bloods, they said everyone should really have a chest radiograph by 12 weeks. And the bloods include a fairly basic data set. And I think that probably it's not unreasonable to consider these ones in addition, particularly the D-dimer earlier in the course of the recovery. And then a simple exercise test, usually a sit to stand, recording heart rate, saturations, repetitions, and of course, breathlessness. And another thing you can do fairly easily in a clinic is a 6-minute walk or a shuttle test. So that's the sort of basic slash intermediate workup for respiratory disease. There are some important points that NICE guideline 188 brings out as well, I think, and really relevant here is that a plain chest radiograph when reported as normal isn't enough to exclude lung disease or pulmonary vascular disease. Also important to consider referral for psychological therapies if patients have mental health symptoms, such as anxiety or depression. And I think Boon really also touched on this as well. And obviously liaison psychiatry if there's more complex needs. But critically here, after you've ruled out the serious complications and alternative diagnosis, then referring into a multidisciplinary long COVID clinic from 4 weeks onwards. Now, here's an example from an old trainee of mine who's done, who's a sports and exercise medicine consultant, and she spent some time working at Headley Court, which is the Ministry of Defence Rehab Centre. So she really knows what she's talking about. And I'm very grateful for her to giving me these this model pathway of hers. So she set up a clinic in Tunbridge Wells. And it starts with a phone call to the physiotherapist and some basic questions after 6 weeks from onset of symptoms. And if you answer yes to these questions, so you're improving, for example, you can walk and hold a conversation, you've got no chest pain, no palpitations, and you only sleep or rest for 1 hour or once a day, then you can be fed into basic level physiotherapy, and then following that discharged. But if after some sessions you're triggering on the Yorkshire screening tool, then you go into her clinic, which will feed into an MDT and an interdisciplinary clinic. Now, so I've expanded that. She's expanded that here in this next slide of hers, which is basically overlapping with the previous one. Once you go into her clinic, then there's a simple management followed by a 4-week review. And if you're triggering a number of warning signs, you can go into see multiple disciplines. The predominant one really is physiotherapy. And so respiratory medicine obviously sits in a fairly major place within this multidisciplinary team unit. She also discusses these patients in an IDT clinic. So there's an example, I think, of a really excellent pathway that many of us are trying to mimic. And so thank you to her for saving me a lot of time with that slide. So in terms of the respiratory aspect, and I want to focus on that, it's important just basically, that's an ear, if you're wondering what it is. It's a PowerPoint version of an ear. It's important to try and separate out functional, emotional, and psychological issues from those which suggest dual pathology, such as cardiac sounding chest pain or musculoskeletal dysfunction, from organic. Now, I don't know, I had to sort of really make this up based on experience, but if patients presenting with persistent cough or predictable and consistent exertional dyspnea, if they are sort of improving but still off their baseline, this may point to some organic pathology, as opposed to patients who describe this unsatisfactory breathing, or they're mouth breathers, or they have a lot of anxiety and poor sleep, and it's episodic and it's not related to exertion. They may say it's on talking a lot or on the phone. These things point much more towards a functional respiratory issue. A questionnaire that can be used is the Nijmegen questionnaire, which is aiming to pick out hyperventilation, which is one form of dysfunctional breathing. and a score of 23 out of 64 suggests hyperventilation. But I don't know about you, but I really hate scores. So, you know, for those of who trained before smartphones, we weren't used to having scores. And I think what this really helps with is a list of questions that makes you think of dysfunctional breathing. And so I would use this really to point me in that direction. So this then it can lead you almost directly to physiotherapy, either from seeing a respiratory physician or from your own surgery or clinic. So, of course, you treat the treatable at this stage, and then patients get fed into this pathway after that. Now, we've said what the basic workup is. Now, if a patient was to come and see me because there is this suspicion of respiratory disease, then I'm going to give you two potential pathways. I think this is the standard pathway that you'll find most pulmonologists using around the UK. So there will be a set of questionnaires and basic investigations, which we've covered already, and then a baseline data set, which will include lung function, possibly an echocardiogram or ECG if there's a cardiac flavor to it, some imaging. Now, I've suggested, because we have at Welbeck, and I really like this, a dual energy CT scan. We can talk about that more in the discussion if you like. And we have this at Imperial, a nuclear medicine ventilation perfusion CT SPECT, which is a bit of a mouthful. But these are really excellent for picking out pulmonary vascular as well as pulmonary fibrotic complications. But your good old friend, the CTPA, may be, of course, very helpful for all of those things. And then you can assess further with advanced physiology. Now, I'm going to be slightly provocative as somebody who loves the exercise test, the cardiopulmonary exercise test, to say that actually what you may be able to do in many cases beyond the 12-week time point is to use this almost as your filtering test. Cardiopulmonary exercise testing and gas diffusion with lung function. If you do this test and you find that gas exchange and the cardiac profile is completely normal, then you can consider that the patient may be deconditioned and you can recommend rehab. If there's abnormal gas exchange, you go down the imaging route. If there's abnormal cardiac response, you do a cardiac workup, and you can also see breathing pattern disorders. So here's just a 9-panel plot. Bear in mind, I've reported about 9,000 of these in my life, so this is just pattern recognition for me. But I'm just putting up here the sort of information you can get on this patient who was post-COVID. He developed normal peak power. He had normal gas exchange. He had a normal stroke volume response, normal heart rate response, no desaturation, normal peak VO2, and he had an early anaerobic threshold suggesting deconditioning. But when you look at him on a breath by breath basis, you note also by observing it, he's a mouth breather, but he takes these big sighs up to about 3.5 to 4 liters. And you can see as he progresses through the exercise test, so we have rest, working at 0 watts and then a ramp of increased work, you can see he takes these big breaths in because he doesn't feel like he's getting the air in. And I think that's because he's a mouth breather. And you can pick up these things, and they're getting more and more close together, which is very hard to sustain at peak exercise. So the breathlessness really comes from this concept of what your body is thinking, how hard you're going to have to work, how breathless ought I to be for this level of exercise. And then you get the sensory inputs from the lungs. So the lungs have gone through this inflammatory process to stiffen them. And the brain doesn't match up the degree of effort that you've got with the sensory inputs. And so this leads to a heightened perception of breathlessness. And of course, the breathlessness then leads to inactivity and the muscle conditioning following on from that with leg fatigue and further inactivity. This leads to early anaerobic metabolism, more lactate, CO2 production, and more breathlessness. So you have this vicious circle which people enter into. And it can get quite complex. And this is why we need our friends, the respiratory physiotherapists, to help out, because we've got this breathing, thinking, functioning complex, which leads to breathlessness. So you're starting off with inefficient breathing, perhaps because there has been some gas exchange change in the lungs, and particularly, well, there will have been at the time of COVID. And this leads to increased respiratory rate and possibly hyperinflation. These feed around and cause worse breathlessness. This leads to an increased attention to their sensation of breathlessness, some flashbacks, particularly in the ICU patients, and some really deep and dark thoughts about dying. It feeds into anxiety, which worsens the breathlessness. And then, of course, this impacts on function in terms of isolation and activity being reduced. So just to sort of really finish up, this is my last slide. From a respiratory angle, of course, if you find something pathological, you're going to treat it as best you can. But in the context of long COVID, it's predominantly going to be physiotherapy based. Now, there's the Your COVID Recovery pathway from the NHS. But of course, we can also recommend one-to-one physiotherapy for breathing pattern disorders. And here's a really good resource for that. We can also supervise managed return to exercise using things like wearable technologies, for example, and some people may even go through pulmonary rehab. We at Hammersmith were using personalized exercise programs, which were given to patients by the physio. We had the ICU physio come down and join us in the clinic, and a sports and exercise medicine consultant. Of course, many patients will need feeding on to additional psychological support. But I think it's really important to have a repeat point of contact with the patient so that they know they haven't been sort of sent into the ether, and always be prepared to reconsider the diagnosis. But just to say that we are kind of making this up as we go along, and we're building the pathways as we learn more and more about it. I'm fairly sure I've run over time. I apologize for that. But thank you very much for your attention.
Luke, that was brilliant. Well worth running over for. And those practical pathways are really useful, actually. We're going to move on to Professor Claire Hopkins. Claire is a professor at Guy's, and she's president of the British Rhinological Society. I'm sure you might have read her articles in the BMJ. And she was the first person to identify the link between COVID and anosmia.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk about the unbearable absence of smelling and management of COVID-associated olfactory dysfunction. So post-viral olfactory loss is actually nothing new. And even in times before COVID, if we can think back that far, it was one of the most common causes of olfactory dysfunction. And it could account for anything up to 40% of cases of anosmia presenting to an ENT clinic, depending on the setting. It was more common in females, particularly aged between 40 to 70. 80% reported significant improvement within a year, 50% developed parosmia, a distorted sense of smell. But what was quite different was it was actually relatively rare in terms of the incidence of upper respiratory tract infections, and less than 1% led to severe olfactory dysfunction. Now, there's typically a seasonal peak around March. And in March last year, when I started to see one or two cases of olfactory loss, this wasn't particularly unusual. But after my 10th young, healthy patient in a row who had suddenly lost their sense of smell, I started to get a little concerned, even though at that point we still rather naively thought that COVID was really only found in people returning from Italy or China. I spoke to colleagues around the world and found that in France, in Italy, in the US, ENT colleagues were also seeing a sudden increase in the number of young, healthy patients with a very severe and sudden onset loss of smell. And what was most interesting was about 50% of frontline doctors in Italy working on COVID wards had also suddenly lost their smell. Now, these patients were walking around in the community completely unaware that they may have COVID. They didn't have a cough or fever. So I realized that it was potentially quite a good marker to pick up relatively asymptomatic transmission, and felt that I should at least alert ENT surgeons around the country for the need to wear PPE. So I sent out this press release on March the 19th, thinking if at best it might reach half a dozen ENT surgeons, they may be better able to protect themselves. I was slightly taken aback when, in the first 72 hours, my press release travelled around the world more rapidly than virus itself. And I found myself on the front page of many newspapers, from the Telegraph, the Times, the New York Times, Washington Post, to the South China Post, and even the Sun and the Daily Mail. And I think what really helped to spread publicity was that a number of very high profile people also lost their sense of smell, from NBA players to politicians, to even Gary Lineker's son. So it really picked up a lot of traction very quickly. We now know that loss of smell is one of the most common symptoms of COVID, and more than 2 out of 3 patients report smell loss. But actually, if you do sensitive olfactory testing, nearly 100% have a detectable loss. It's one of the strongest predictors of a positive PCR result. So not only is it the most sensitive, but it's also the most specific. So if you lose your sense of smell suddenly, there aren't many other things that can cause it in the absence of other viruses or a head injury. And therefore, there's at least a 95% chance that it's COVID related. You're 20 times more likely to test positive than negative. We know it's also slightly more common in milder cases, but it's unclear if that's simply because patients are too sick to notice. It may be the only symptom in about 1 in 6 patients, or it may come before or after other symptoms. It's usually very severe and sudden onset, but can be milder in some cases. And most typically, there isn't a blocked or runny nose associated with it. So patients report it as being really strange that suddenly they wake up and they can't smell or taste their cup of coffee. It's often associated with a burning or tingling pain in the nose, what we call chemesthesis, an eye and sinus pain. And one patient described to me, it feels as if the hairs from the inside of her nose were burning off. And actually, when we look at the olfactory epithelium, that's exactly what happens. The very fine cilia are destroyed by the virus. Patients often report taste loss at the same time, but this is usually a function of loss of smell. So we normally smell the flavour of our food when we chew and release odours. But some patients also have a true taste loss. They lose the ability to distinguish between salty, sweet and sour. But this itself is usually very short lived. So when thinking about long COVID, the first important question is, do patients get better and regain their sense of smell? Well, often this is the case, but as in Prince Charles's case and many others, not all will regain their normal sense of smell and taste. Now, there's a slight difference when we look at self-reported, patient-reported loss of smell and the results from these more sensitive tests. And here's an example. We may use a sort of scratch and sniff test to try and work out the absolute level of their ability to smell. When you ask patients to self-report smell loss at the beginning of COVID, they tend to underestimate. And as I said, with sensitive testing, you can detect smell loss in as many as 100%. And when they recover, they tend to overestimate the level of their recovery. So many will report their sense of smell coming back to normal, but we can still detect persistent deficits. Now, perhaps this is less relevant, as if the patient feels they've got normal function, it doesn't matter quite so much. But when we look at both of those, this is an early study we did looking at 8 weeks recovery. And what you can see is that week on week, there's a gradual improvement in their overall smell testing results, this line going up here. And you can see the number with normal function here, only about a third at the onset, gradually improving up to about 80% at 2 months. When we look at another cohort we studied, now we followed out to 6 months, you can see that actually, unfortunately, between about 2 and 6 months, there isn't really much further improvement. So about 80% will report complete recovery at 6 months, but about 5% still have severe complete loss of smell, and about 15% still have mild to moderate loss of smell. When we look at the smell testing results, the results are perhaps even more disappointing. Here we see that profound loss of smell, anosmia group at about 7%, but only 40% have truly regained all the olfactory dysfunction, and about 53% still have persistent hyposmia or reduced sense of smell. And it's this group in particular that we think then have problems with parosmia. So parosmia is a smell distortion. Anything that you eat or drink smells very strange and typically quite unpleasant. People describe it as an acrid, almost burnt plastic type of smell. It's triggered particularly by things such as onion, garlic, coffee, but it really can come on with anything. So we have people explaining that even water tastes vile, so it has significant impact on their appetite. And it can be even more distressing than the period of complete smell loss. We found that like with other post-viral loss, it affects about 50% of people with COVID. It typically starts about 3 months after infection, and it's thought to be a positive predictive sign of long-term recovery. We see as the olfactory neurons start to regenerate, when they're immature, they don't function properly, and they trigger this very unpleasant smell. It typically lasts anything between 6 to 18 months. So as you can see in this study here, 80% of people we studied at 6 months still hadn't seen any improvement in their parosmia, but it does predict good long-term outcome. So based on current estimates in the UK, 3.5 million confirmed cases, about 1.2 million will have developed complete loss of smell. About 60,000 at least will have persistent complete loss of smell at 6 months. And as many as over 500,000 will be suffering with parosmia at the current time. And it has a huge impact on patients. This is one picture that a patient sent me of smells that they miss. This is a really profound letter from one of my ophthalmology colleagues. And one of the things he noted was that everyone's very excited about making the diagnosis, but no one really seems to care what happens to them after that. He said that anosmia is like experiencing the world in two dimensions. Appetite is gone, I have no smells to evoke good memories. I'm constantly worried about missing unhealthy fumes. My friends trivialise this and show no empathy. And these are very common themes expressed by patients who have lost their smell. It's been completely overlooked by the long COVID recovery plan and by the diagnostic paper put out by NICE. It has a wider impact on patients. And one study looking at COVID patients found that the level of depression and anxiety correlated much better with loss of smell than with any other symptoms. We've looked at patients and found that they express a loss of libido, lack of connection with others, concerns about body odour, eating and appetite issues. And we know that patients with anosmia are at a higher risk of being exposed to household fires and food poisoning. Here's a very good example reported in the press last week, with a family in Texas having to be rescued. Three of the family members lost their sense of smell from COVID. Only the teenage daughter escaped, and she was able to awake the family and rescue them from the house when no one else could smell the fire. So what do patients want from us? Well, this is a word cloud taken from a patient group. And really what they want is hope, understanding, support. And actually you see treatment in very small letters at the top because they realise that this is a recovery process and there may not be very much that we can do to assist them. And really they just want our understanding. They want to have validation of their symptoms. And we've heard that in some of the other talks. But unfortunately, this is patients' experience of consultations, both with GPs and ENT. Largely, they feel that they're dismissed, they're simply not listened to, and they don't get that compassion and understanding that they need. So they might describe it as a complete waste of time. So how can we do better? Well, we've put some resources together, which I'll circulate at ENT UK, to give advice sheets to patients and patient videos. We've also put together some guidelines on best treatment practice, looking at the evidence base, both from COVID, although that's obviously very limited, and from post-viral loss in general. Essentially, we recommend olfactory training for all patients, and I'll come back to that. There is probably a role for oral steroids, topical steroids, and possibly a role for vitamin A drops and omega-3 supplements, particularly around the four-week period. So what we see is about 50% get better very quickly in the first 2 weeks, and these group need nothing. But if things are persisting at 4 weeks, then these are the group that are likely to go on to have long-term problems. So this is probably the sweet spot in terms of starting treatment. We would recommend ENT review, certainly if they have ongoing nasal obstruction, which is unusual in COVID, just to rule out other diagnoses. And there is no indication from the smell loss itself that an MRI scan would be useful. Now, we've got evidence from oral corticosteroids and post-viral loss in general, but this is a study we've recently published looking at COVID patients. And this was the group receiving oral steroids at 4 weeks who get a significantly greater improvement in olfactory scores than those that don't. Now, what we haven't done is followed this group longer over time to see whether they all reach the same endpoint. But if there are no contraindications for taking oral steroids, I would certainly consider a course at around 4 weeks of persistent loss. And the most important thing is smell training. These are kits that patients can buy from a charity called Absent. And working with Absent, we've put together a very large patient resource. If you ask patients to Google Nosewell, it will take them straight to it. And it has videos showing them how to smell train. It has very useful support on parosmia, recipes and other tips and so on. But essentially, smell training can be done with any essential oils or strong odours around the house. But these are the little kits from Absent. And you encourage a patient to repeatedly take little sniffs of these very strong odours to stimulate the recovering olfactory neurons and encourage them to work properly, making the right connections both in the nose and higher up in the central connections in the brain. And this accelerates recovery and also is likely to help accelerate the parosmia period, which not all patients go through, but is very common, as I've said before. There are other possibilities that are currently being trialled, and there are trials about to report looking at omega-3, and there is good evidence from radiotherapy that it helps with recovery of the olfactory system, and so I'm recommending it to all patients. Vitamin A drops, I think it's still the jury is out and we need larger trials. And one of the things that I'm very interested in looking at is the injection of platelet-rich plasma. There's a study in Stanford that's due to report in the near future. And should this be successful, I hope it's something we'll be able to offer to OneWelbeck in the very near future. And so certainly it shows promise in a pilot study, but we're just awaiting those final results. So in essence, medical treatment is limited. Spontaneous improvement is likely. And it still has a chance to continue beyond the first 12 to 18 months. So it's really important to say to patients that there is still hope. What's most important is not to say, right now it's 12 months, it's definitely permanent, because patients find that really difficult to cope with. And there is still a chance for improvement several years after the onset. This is the NoseBug website, open access to all patients, and it's a very good resource that we put together, hopefully that patients will find very useful. This is one of the things taken from it. It shows patients typical triggers and helps them to look at what they might avoid in their diet to help get through the parosmia stage. There's also a second charity, Fifth Sense, also supporting patients with smell loss, and they have some different resources and some online webinars that patients can join in as well. So in summary, loss of smell and taste are amongst the most prevalent and most specific symptoms of COVID. There's a high rate of early recovery, but about 10% will have severe persistent loss. There's a high rate of parosmia, and smell training and support are really important. Thanks very much for your time.
Thank you, Claire. That was brilliant. I think it's really nice as well for patients to have something they can do rather than just wait for their symptoms to get better. Thank you to all our speakers. We're going to move on to questions now. There's lots of questions pinging in. I think Boon has managed to answer a few of them. But one for Claire is, how often would you advise patients do the smell training?
Well, you know, certainly probably more often the better, but at least twice a day. It's about 30 seconds with each odour. We recommend typically rose, eucalyptus, clove and lemon because they cover quite a wide range of different olfactory receptors, but patients can do it with anything at all that they have around the house. But at least twice a day would be the recommended, and for at least 12 weeks.
And just one other one for you, Claire, there. What dose or how long a course of oral steroids for anosmia?
So I give 0.5 milligram per kilogram up to a maximum of 40, and I give it for 5 days.
Okay. Boon, how can you distinguish significant arrhythmias such as AF and SVT from sinus tachycardia when patients are complaining of palpitations in the context of long COVID?
So that's a great question. I think to answer it, I think I need to know whether or not you're behind a Zoom screen with the patient or whether you can be with the patient. So the obvious best answer would be if you're in front of a patient and can take their pulse, the orthostatic component, which is to say when the pulse goes up with standing and palpitations start, sometimes fairly abruptly, as you've seen in the tilt table tests, is a sign that this is most likely to do with sinus tachycardia, which is what I would call a reactive sinus tachycardia. And this is very distinct from, for example, AFib or an SVT, where the onset of symptoms are not related to any postural changes. So the abrupt nature, for example, waking up at night with a sudden onset tachycardia is potentially less likely to be with sinus tachycardia and more likely to be with atrial fibrillation or an SVT.
Luke, I think this is about that study from the University of Sheffield this week. It's talking about that new scanner to detect long-term changes from COVID. And what do you think of this scan? I think you touched on it in your talk, didn't you?
Yeah, I did when I talked about over-investigation. I think it's fascinating. And I think these research studies are really important. What becomes difficult is, and I had this a few months ago, was when this hits the headlines that doctors could be missing huge amounts of underlying lung disease that only the hyperpolarized spin xenon MRI can detect. And you just think, oh my goodness, you know, I know what question I'm going to be asked next time I do a clinic. And indeed I was. So I think it's obviously, it is an interesting test, and it picks up very subtle changes in ventilation perfusion mismatch. And what I did immediately was go to my colleagues who do dual energy CT scanning and also who do ventilation perfusion scanning, good old fashioned VQ scanning. And I said, if I've got access to these things, am I going to miss anything that a xenon scan is going to pick up? And they said, no, you'll be fine. Don't worry. The great thing about the MR scan is it doesn't involve radiation. Who knows what it will teach us? It may be that there's something there that we don't yet quite know. But I think you're okay with what you've got at present.
We've got just a few minutes left, and I think this goes back to Boone's breathing. Tell me how breathing can help with this bottom-up approach to influence the autonomic nervous system, and how might a cold shower help?
So I think too much for 5 minutes left we have at a time, but the cold shower aspect, just to start off with, is I think very interesting. I've become a Wim Hof fan and a Wim Hof, I guess, practitioner, because I, since October, have had cold showers every night bar 3 nights when I came back late from work, and 2 other nights when I was feeling chilly all day. But it is very invigorating, and the difference is a cold shower after a warm shower is a very, very sympathetically driving response. In other words, it elicits the same stress response as we were designed to have in primitive days, running away from that saber-toothed tiger. Try it yourself. You get a gasp and then a shocking sensation, just like the Wim Hof breath technique when you take a deep breath and you hold as long as you can. So my longest has been 2 minutes, 15 seconds. And at that time, your senses are truly exploding. And this is a heightened sympathetic surge. Now, the difference here between the acute sympathetic surge and chronic, stable, heightened sympathetic surges is what makes this training very good, because I think you're training your autonomic system to influence your vasculature. So if you have a cold shower, you're vasoconstricting and training those sympathetic fibers in your lower limbs, your upper limbs, your face to constrict very rapidly. And then when you turn the water to warm again, it dilates. And then if you turn it to cold again, alternating warm and cold, it constricts and dilates, and you're doing your form of autonomic training. So that's the answer to the cold shower question. And I've had two patients now who've said to me that they have had a sustained improvement in their long COVID symptoms following this cold shower technique. Now, I guess for the breathing technique, would it be possible if I asked Luke kindly to demonstrate what we're talking about? So I'm a big fan of the biofeedback technique. Luke, do you want to share your screen? I think we might prep for this. Luke, by the way, is a super endurance rower. He kind of just is up there behind James Cracknell. And he will demonstrate his wonderful physique and heart rate variability through this demonstration. But this is the heart math tool, which is a biofeedback tool that you can link to your iPhone, your Android, or your PC. And if Luke can share his screen.
So I'm trying to share my screen. Can you see it now, Boon?
No, not yet. Not yet.
Okay. So, So of course, this will now increase my stress response very significantly. So share screen. Here we are. I'm going to share screen two. Share. Okay, so that's, there we are.
Perfect. So whilst Luke set up, I'm going to just point out that on this white screen that you can see, this is the Inner Balance Heart Math tool. And this is on a PC base, but it's much simpler on your phone. And you can look at the right-hand side and see a blue line going up and down. Luke is going to breathe, and you can see Luke's pulse coming along on the bottom with every beat of his PPG sensor. So this is pulse plethysmography. And what the sensor is doing is detecting Luke's heart rate, as you can see on the top graph, which is slowly but surely inscribing a heart rate trend. And as Luke follows the breathing technique, going inspiring on the up and expiration on the down of the blue bar that's moving on the right-hand side, you can see his heart rate changing. Now, if your patients take control of their heart rate in this way. In fact, you can try and do this yourself as you're watching the screen and listen to the voice, because you are following that blue bar. If you take your own pulse, all of you, you will notice your heart rate start to change like Luke. So Luke has come down just in a space of 50 seconds in the time that I've been speaking. He's managed to calm down. His Zen-like state and training background means that he's gone from 80 beats a minute, and within a minute has hit 60. And in a short while, you'll see he'll come down to 55, no pressure, Luke. And if you follow on this breathing technique, you will find that you are expressing more vagus, because the way that you express heart rate variability, which is this kind of pattern we're seeing right in front of our eyes now, is through respiratory sinus arrhythmia mediated by the vagus nerve. So when you do this kind of deep breathing technique, you are upregulating vagus and actually downregulating the sympathetic nervous system, which is what we want to do to strike balance in this autonomic dysfunction process. On the bottom screen, you might wonder, what is this stuff in green? This is a coherence score. And the way I look at it is an expression of the low versus high frequency. Now, it's too much technical detail, but essentially when you hit it right and you get a high coherence, Luke will tell you, and I will as well, that at the end of 10 minutes of this kind of breathing, which is what I practice twice a day, you feel good. And the patients who do this technique of breathing feels good. And at the end of this, when you express, because when you get the breathing right, and then you think compassion, gratitude, love, and you know, for everything you have and everything around you, the feeling at the end of this is incredibly powerful, a powerful healing way. And this is where you are going from a bottom-up approach to influence the subconscious or autonomic nervous system. I'm sorry that took so long, Di.
We're going to have to finish now. So I'm sorry if I haven't had a chance for all your questions, but thank you to everyone in the audience for attending and putting those questions forward. Huge thank you to our panelists, to Boon, Luke and Claire. It's been really insightful and really, really good practical tips. And also to thank Rupal for all the behind the scenes work and the tech support. If you want any more details, or if you want the details of the consultants, please get in contact with Rupal. Otherwise, have a nice evening.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.